quiet, I sense that that's when you want to start. So I'm going to go ahead and get started with this session. I'm Erica Chenoweth, and I want to thank you all for the opportunity to talk a little bit about some of my work and the work of others about this topic of repression and how movements and campaigns come to prepare for and manage the effects of repression in the course of their struggles. I want to also just acknowledge and express that I have no experience personally with this topic as a practical matter. And because of that, I want to just say that I completely understand if you take what I am going to tell you and you completely discard it, or you take the bits of it that are pearls of wisdom that can be useful and ignore the rest. So with that said, I just will humbly express that you probably have much more direct experience with this than I do. And what I intend to do here is just talk about the ways that one can respond to a bunch of conventional wisdoms that I think interfere with movement's ability to capitalize on or use the political effects of repression to their advantage. So with that said, I want to talk a little bit about my own story and how I came to the field of civil resistance. In 2006, I was a doctoral student, and I was finishing my PhD thesis on the topic of why people resort to political violence so often in countries that are supposedly democratic. And I was invited to a workshop called People, Power, and Pedagogy, which was an ICNC-funded workshop that was essentially an academics-only version of what we're doing here. So I was one of you. I was a participant in the workshop, and I was deeply skeptical of the material. And as we were going through the material, I kept kind of having objections to a lot of the basic assumptions and what I thought were kind of empirical realities of the fact that nonviolent resistance could be an effective force for change. So Maria Stefan and I, she was there as well, and we ended up having some arguments about this, and we were kind of randomly assigned to be roommates. So unfortunately, the arguments persisted late into the night for multiple days in a row. But I'll tell you what happened in the course of those antagonistic conversations was that I was able to express all of my objections to the idea that civil resistance could be an effective force for change compared to violence. And she was able to express the hypotheses about why it could be. And the outcome of that was basically a research design. So the idea was, well, let's figure out which one of our hypotheses is correct. And we developed a project where we looked from 1900 through 2006, because that's when we were meeting. And what we decided to do was place side by side mass campaigns of both nonviolent and violent action and look at which ones of them were succeeding the most. So it was kind of like taking all the campaigns in the world, in every country in the world from that time period, and having a horse race and seeing which ones of these campaigns were actually achieving their objectives, what they said they wanted, more often. We were also really aware of the fact that many people, and this was one of my objections, might think that nonviolent campaigns emerge in contexts where it's easier to win, or they emerge and they formulate around struggles that are easier to win than violent campaigns. For example, maybe nonviolent campaigns would be more successful because they tend to espouse reformist objectives or kind of easy goals, whereas violent campaigns are almost always all or nothing campaigns, that is, removing the incumbent government. So what we did in our study is we only looked at nonviolent campaigns that were also all or nothing campaigns. That is the removal of the incumbent government, complete territorial secession, not autonomy, but secession, and the removal of a foreign military occupation or colonial power. So we're only looking at these maximalist campaigns, those that would fundamentally re-alter the shape of the country in which these struggles were occurring. We also applied a very strict definition of success. When you look at our definition, you understand that at least one of us was a skeptic. And so what we did was we looked only at successes as being total achievement of that objective, that is the removal of the incumbent leader through irregular means, the complete de facto and de jure, that is legal independence of a country. So not significant autonomy, but complete independence. And what we found was that when we looked at those outcomes, the nonviolent campaigns were achieving them about twice as often as their violent counterparts. We also found that they were achieving them at partial success, that is autonomy or elections, for example, more than twice as often as their violent counterparts. So this flies in the face of a lot of conventional wisdom, and since then, much of my life has been devoted to trying to understand why that's the case and when is that the case. And Maria and I wrote a book together called Why Civil Resistance Works that lays out a couple of principles, and I just want to mention my own formulation, which is about four major reasons or four major characteristics of all successful campaigns. The first is that successful campaigns almost always mobilize large and diverse participation. In fact, participation is the most robust predictor of success that we can observe in campaigns. And that means lots of people and people that are cutting across diverse sectors of society. In fact, the diversity of the campaign becomes more and more important the more isolated the campaign is. Say it's like an ethnic minority or something. That makes it even more important to have very cross-cutting participation in the campaign. I'll show you some evidence about that later. The second major feature of successful campaigns is that they're able to induce shifts in the loyalty of people that reside in various pillars of support for the opponent. So whether that's security force defections, whether that's civilian bureaucrats walking out of work, whether that's key elements of the state-run labor forces that decide no longer to go to work or begin to speak out on behalf of the campaign, whatever the really important pillars are that are holding up that power holder, when campaigns are able to create divisions within them and start pulling their obedience away from the power holder, they tend to be much more likely to succeed. The third major feature of successful campaigns is that they don't rely on a single tactic or method of struggle. That is, they don't do demonstration after demonstration after demonstration after demonstration. They mix their techniques. They look like they're on the offensive. They're not always reactive. And in fact, they have a sequence in mind to both respond to and remain resilient to repression. And then that leads me to the fourth category, which is staying power. The average nonviolent campaign takes about 3 years to run its course, from the time that it sets on in our data set, which is when it's mobilized 1,000 people, to the end. 3 years, okay? So if there was like one fact that I could have the world know that would benefit movements, it's the staying power, the amount of time that movements have to think about that they need to be around before the full political effects of their mobilization are seen. 3 years. Now for armed struggle, this is for those of you that are skeptics or those of you who have to argue with skeptics like me. For armed struggle, the average is 9 years. It's longer. Most people think nonviolent resistance is slow, armed struggle is fast. It's the opposite. So those are kind of the four key things. And the last one, this thing about staying power, really feeds into this discussion here. Okay, so how does a movement of unarmed people establish staying power in societies where there is a committed opponent willing to use lethal repression against them? There are very few laws in social science. Hardy made reference to a law of physics in the last session, which is that if you have momentum going in every direction, the net momentum is zero. Love that. I wish we could have more of that in social science. But there is a law in social science that my friend Chris Davenport calls the law of coercive responsiveness. That's a fancy way of saying whether you're unarmed or armed or whatever, if you are going to challenge the status quo and you are going to challenge a power holder's legitimacy and ability to rule, they are going to try to hurt you. That's a law. The law is that whenever we observe dissent through violation of legal, institutional, or social norms, violent repression is visited upon the dissidents. Now, there's a lot of variation in the types of repression that we see. There's variation in the agents. Who does it? Is it uniformed military and security forces? Is it paramilitary? Is it thugs? Is it plainclothes police? Is it the opponent's loyalists? So there's variation in the agents of repression. There is variation in the degree of repression. How widespread is it? That is, who's punished for this? There's variation in the scope of repression, which is against whom specifically. And there's variation in the intensity. How lethal is it? Just how lethal is it? The conventional wisdom is that unarmed people are helpless in the face of a committed repressive opponent. What I'm going to do in this session is challenge that view using a variety of different studies and empirical evidence from different cases around the world to show you how movements have not only survived and remained resilient in the face of repression, but in some cases have even capitalized on the repression to benefit themselves politically. So take a second and read this quote and take a guess about who said this. So wait until everybody's read it, and then I'll ask you who said it. Okay. Oh, that's a good, we can't play 20 questions, but that's a good guess. No, he's not American. Who said it? Who said it? Who wants to guess? Churchill, Gandhi, right? Okay, who?
Machiavelli,
good guess, not right. What else?
Mao,
good guess, not right. Who else? Hitler, who said Hitler? Gay, ding, 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 silver star. Okay, why did you guess Hitler?
I didn't originally.
Yeah, right. But we were running out of options, right? It's does everybody know Godwin's law? Godwin's law. No. Godwin's law is a communications law, which is that if you read a blog post or a news article, it only takes 3 comments in the comments section for somebody to bring up Hitler. Yeah, it's totally. Yeah, so this is just trivia, but in a comment section of a blog post or a news article, if you just look 3 deep into the comment section, somebody's going to mention Hitler for some reason, especially if you do nonviolent resistance. Actually, I think we have to modify Godwin's law and say that it takes only 2 for somebody to bring up Hitler. Would nonviolent resistance have worked against Hitler? Come on, you know, that kind of thing. Okay, So here we have Adolf Hitler admitting, and actually in 1943, after the tide of the war had turned and the Nazis were feeling somewhat encircled, so to speak, this is Hitler referring to ruling the so-called conquered regions. And by that he meant like Poland, Czechoslovakia, the Balkans, Denmark, Norway. He was referring to the fact that we cannot rule these conquered people with force. He's privately admitting this to his lieutenants. Okay, so why is this important? Because even Hitler recognizes the model that no power holder, no matter how dictatorial, how total their power looks like from the outside, is free from the fact that their power is 100% dependent on the cooperation, obedience, and help of people that reside in various pillars of their support, whether that be the security forces, their regime entourage, economic elites, business elites, civilian bureaucrats, the state media, religious authorities and cultural authorities in the society, educational elites and intelligentsia. They're reliant on the cooperation of these people to basically just keep obeying, keep obeying, keep obeying, and the system works fine. But as soon as these people start to question whether it's in their own long-term interest to continue to obey, that power is in trouble. And in fact, the idea is that in these pillars of support, there are people that live in the country. They live in the society. They have to operate with their neighbors. They want to continue to buy liquor from the same liquor store. They don't want that guy to kick them out. There are all kinds of relationships in these societies that make it so that the people who are in these pillars of support are interested in maintaining their own comfort in the society in the long term, whether or not the power holder remains the same. So the idea here is that power must be constantly replenished for the power holder. And that's why we often see dictators, for example, purging their elite base, because they fear this fact. Now, when we think about this and its political impacts, it's not too surprising that many regimes try to adopt hybrid or sort of smart repression techniques. And I'm going to talk a little bit about some of those that we've observed in recent years, but that I think are actually pretty typical of campaigns, even going back into the mid-20th century and before. The first thing is that regime opponents typically try to blame foreigners and outsiders for the unrest. So everybody's like, oh, what do I do if they accuse me of being part of a conspiracy? Join the club. They basically all accuse the movement of being part of a foreign conspiracy. The second thing they try to do is mischaracterize them and proffer some Photoshop evidence to demonstrate that these co-conspirators are terrorists or coup plotters or communists, that's the bad word in the United States, or traitors. So, you know, they come up with all kinds of degrading nomenclature to describe ordinary people who are unarmed and trying to exercise their basic rights. The third thing they try to do is co-opt. So some people brought this up yesterday. And here I'm going to say co-optation maybe is most troubling when the people are basically bought and pulled into the power holder's close circle. So this is, you know, by being elected or into the parliament and then being pulled in and starting gaining lots of privileges. The fourth thing they can do is pay off their inner entourage. So the inner entourage is the minimum number of people you need to stay in power. So if that's your economic elites, make sure that their bank account is just full and they're very happy. If it's security forces, make sure they get all the privileges in the society. If it's the state media, make sure that they're taken well care of. Does everybody know about the Saudi non-Arab Spring experience? So in Saudi Arabia, when there started to be about 25 people that started to protest, the Saudi government just cut everybody in the society about a $10,000 check. And the message was clear. Okay, I'll take my check and deposit it, and I'll, you know, pay off some of my debt or whatever. It's like Alaska. We have that in the U.S. too. Everybody in Alaska gets like a $10,000 subsidy every year. Oil helps. Actually, oil-based economies are in some sense the most robust, in part because they have so much extra surplus sovereign wealth that they can just do that. And it's a really, you know, robust way of coup-proofing. Although Norway is, of course, everyone's favorite counterexample. Did you want to say something?
Does everybody know what Uber is? You know what Uber is? Well, they just announced today in the New York Times that Uber is doubling the subsidy in China for those who basically drive for them. Now, this seems like a cool thing to do. They've got billions. But the question is, after they pay them once, what do they do the next time to keep them in the cars? And I think that's the issue here, isn't it?
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. So, you know, the fact that they can do this once doesn't mean that they're, you know, off the hook, because power has to be constantly replenished, of course, if you sort of buy that theory. The next thing that often happens is that there are plainclothes police and agents provocateurs that are planted in to crowds. And what do? They start to provoke street fighting. What happens when street fighting starts? Well, usually women disappear, elderly disappear, people with physical limitations or disabilities disappear, and it becomes all guys. And that basically cuts your mobilization participant base by about over 50%. And that really hurts the movement. And we'll talk about that more tomorrow morning, but the placement of Aujon's provocateurs is, again, basically a challenge that almost every movement observed in our data set has had to come up with a solution for. Another thing they often do is try to delegate repression to people that don't look like state agents. They look like other ordinary people. So let's give $250 a head to a bunch of thugs to go out and start roughing people up, or intimidating them in their neighborhood, or using paramilitaries with unmarked cars. There are all sorts of things that happen that are meant to intimidate, harass, and threaten ordinary people using these methods. When it becomes escalatory, there is often a resort to the use of terror. Terror is a discriminate form of violence that basically tries to have a psychological impact beyond the act itself. That's when there's a truly horrific thing that happens to somebody that's widely publicized, and it scares everyone else into submission. The reason, by the way, that states resort to terror is because they know they can't repress all the people all the time. So what they want to do is scare all the people all the time. And they can do that by just hurting one person in a way that really touches on our deepest, darkest fears. The next thing that often happens is censorship, surveillance, spinning. And these are all ways to sort of motivate propaganda in a way that demobilizes the movement. Keeping foreign journalists out, it's no accident that at the onset of the Arab Spring, the first thing that most of the threatened Arab regimes did was kick out foreign journalists, because they do not want a witness. Why don't they want a witness? I don't know. I don't know if international criminal courts have been very effective, but I do know that activists say on the ground in those contexts that when they feel seen, it motivates them to act. And so it's actually a deterrent to make them look like they're invisible to the rest of the world. They use pseudo-legitimate laws and practices, for example, outlawing foreign agents and foreign NGOs and foreign funding. And then they also actually have meetings like the one we're having now, where they get together and they talk about the best practices these days for suppressing nonviolent dissidents. And they get think tanks to organize and release reports on best practices. Now, this is very helpful for movements. It's helpful for the regimes, but it's also helpful for movements to know what the playbook is. So let's talk a little bit about, and if Amber can help me out here. Oh, yeah, yes. Absolutely. Sometimes you have to look in the original language, but yes, they're often online in the form of think tank reports and so forth. Okay, yeah.
And I'm just interested, for example, the first point, these are foreigners, these are outsiders, etc. Mm-hmm. In the U.S. movement, mm-hmm. do you recall this? I would be interested to know mm-hmm. who the outsiders for a U.S. movement would
yeah.
be, like the Seattle people.
Or yeah, whatever. I mean, right. They, if they were called so usually during the Cold War, it was very much they were funded by the Soviet Union. And there was a huge paranoia about the idea that communism was invading the U.S. through these sort of subversive civil society organizations.
The civil struggle?
The civil rights? Oh, absolutely. I mean, Martin Luther King was accused many times by the FBI and others of being a Soviet agent and, you know, a communist agent. And that was very much part of the scene. Today, I think that, there's still kind of remnants of that.
Anti-fracking protesters paid by Russia.
Oh, yeah. Right. I mean, there's the idea that, you know, there's all kinds of different foreign interests based on corporate interests and things that are motivating these people. Yeah.
Yes, I just wanted to make a comment because I did my PhD on manipulation. And mm-hmm. this was just a key argument when people start to think not about their interest, but about someone's interest and play this game, mind games. Okay, this is beneficial to one.
Yeah.
If you're not a professional campaigner, it will just drive you nowhere.
Right.
But that's
right.
The effect. It was always foreign force. I just, all this. The list was used in Ukraine.
And, yeah, it was.
I got the whole list.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, these are, so this was actually, more or less, this list was derived in the late 2000s, so around 2007, 2008, by a group of, the usual suspects who were meeting in an open meeting, and one of our colleagues was there at the meeting doing her PhD research and came up with, you know, some of these, and then we've sort of added the list. But yeah, I mean, you're more or less going to see this in every context these days. And in fact, I'd make the argument that they've happened before now, but that now we just have a list. Yes?
I was asking myself, is killing is not a repression?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Killing, there was no killing amongst your...
Right.
Can you example?
Yeah.
It comes to me, the last example in Burundi.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
And they killed the most young and active...
Right.
Mobilizer. Mm-hmm. He was... He belonged to a political party, but he was strong mobilizer, mm-hmm. and he has been killed.
Right.
And he has an effect on...
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Absolutely. So this list that I just gave you all, I would call the smart repression list. There's also repression. There's killing, there's brutality, there's beatings, there's arrests, there's torture. I mean, yeah, that's actually the list of things that I'm going to turn to now and talk about the sort of lethal repression. But I just wanted to give you this smart repression list because I think movements are behind on coming up with really concerted ways to respond and react to that list of best practices for regimes. And I don't know that there's any single place these days where movements have a set of best practices in responding to these things. I have to move on, but I'm going to take one more thought and then we'll move on.
I just wanted to say, and I'm not sure where it fits, I'm sure somewhere, but criminalization,
mm-hmm.
because with Peace Brigades International, when we did analysis, I think especially in the last 5 years, that was a fairly new and very sophisticated tactic
yeah.
by a lot of regimes to
for
keep
sure.
people down. And I think it probably yeah. fits somewhere, but I think it's important.
Yeah, I would put that under the sort of pseudo-legitimate laws and sort of outlawing certain types of behavior or saying that people are, you know, they're just criminals or they're drug addicts or, you know.
And it's the hardest yeah. to fight because it's under
right.
the legal system.
Exactly.
So yeah.
Right, so you have to figure out, like, how to deal, especially in a legal system that itself is highly corrupt. Although in some countries, you can rely to some degree on the legal system to start to act in the way it's supposed to. So what I'd like to do now is just ask you to raise your hand, and we'll call on you. And the idea is to try to put yourself in the shoes of that regime now, the power holder himself, and think about, why are you repressing people? What is the repression meant to achieve? So raise hands and I'll call on people. Lilit.
I would do that, I mean, not I, of course, but still. Well, probably because for keeping the power, maybe they have done some criminal past or some illegal actions which they don't want to be revealed.
Okay, so first of all, to keep power, and second of all, to cover up things you don't want seen. Okay, go ahead.
Maybe because I want to send a signal to my allies, mm-hmm. I'm still there for
yes, to restore unity to the opponent. Right. Mel?
Keep
your privileges. Okay, keep your privileges.
Money? Wealth?
How would you make wealth from repression? Okay, right, so retaining privileges is, yeah, and wealth. Sarah?
Maintain national unity.
Okay, restore or maintain national unity. Amir?
Like to have control on the natural resources in a place where it's like highly full of resources and all.
Right, okay, so natural resources. So this is all under kind of preserving privileges. But, I mean, the act of repression itself, you know, what is it, what's the act meant to achieve? Go ahead.
For me, it would be because I know better, you know, people don't know what they want, democracy doesn't work. I know better what's the best mm-hmm. for people, and I'll repress to keep that better.
Okay, so maybe express my legitimacy. Okay, Mohammed. To create fear. Yeah, to scare everyone else. Ahmad.
Stop anarchy.
Okay, right, to make the unrest stop. Make it stop, right. Yeah. Hamza.
Prevent any retaliation.
Okay. Okay. So deter future action. Okay.
Yeah. Send a message and intimidate those that who potentially
Right, exactly, right. Demobilize, just make everybody go home. Right, Ramona, did you have a thought?
It's to intimidate and to make people refrain from joining the...
Okay, right. We've got most of it. Yeah, go ahead.
So that I have the power and I'm powerful.
Yeah, yes. Make a statement, right. Okay, good. So this is, yeah, flex muscles, I like that. Here we have a list of what repression is meant to do. And there are a couple other things in here too. Sometimes there's research out there that shows that sometimes what happens is regimes use repression to give themselves more information about which of their units is loyal. So they might dispatch a certain unit and see who actually does the repression and who doesn't. So sometimes it's an information updating mechanism. Sometimes they do it to create unity and bonds in a unit, because we have research that shows when people do violent stuff together, they feel closer together. So there's all sorts of kind of internal reasons for doing this, and there are all kinds of external reasons for doing this, which is suppression. So, okay, here's the next question, and we'll do hands again. Sure, or you could put it over here and then over there. What's the opposite of each of these things? What would be the exact opposite from a movement's perspective of each of these items? So let's start with to keep power or conceal. What would be the opposite of that? Yeah.
I'm so sorry, I want to go back to the previous one because there was a few important things. For example, during the starving area, they would repress to find out the, like, really people who would be revolutionaries, and so they
right,
would
to expose, right.
read of them. So mm-hmm. they would repress and see who's actually checking on somebody else, or who's like actually...
Right. The loyalty check, right.
Yeah, the loyalty check. And then they would get rid of those that actually are like that. They would only jail those that are stubborn and they just don't give up. So this is also another way, like, they keep those people that are normally not loyal to them, but normally loyal.
Yeah.
But also repress. Sometimes they would repress not to keep their own power, if this is a semi-colonial place, but to keep the power of the colonists.
Right. Yeah. So updating information, is that on there? Oh yeah, test loyalty. We got it. Okay. So what are the opposites of these things? Let's raise hands. Ahmad.
The first one will be dialogues with the opponents.
Okay, the opposite of to keep power is to dialogue, is that right? Go ahead, Ahmad.
I mean to dialogue with the opponents in order to stop their protests, demonstrations like this and that.
Okay. This is a perfectly valid answer. So let's put it on the board somewhere. Let's put it in a bracket under opposites. Let's keep going on the opposite of to keep power. What's the opposite of that? We're doing hands, folks. We're doing hands. Yeah. Okay, delegitimize regime. And take them out of power. Bring things to light, right? That's the opposite of concealing. What about restoring unity? What would be the opposite of restoring unity? Yes, break unity apart. Threaten the loyalty of the regime. How about keep privileges and wealth? Okay, like decentralize the privileges or remove the regime's monopoly on privilege, okay? What about restore national unity? You could. Well, we could disintegrate national unity, or we could think about expressing the pluralism of the society, right? Yeah, redefining the nation. Yes, exactly. Express legitimacy. What's the opposite? What's that? Okay. Go for an election. Okay. Or actually, you could think about challenge the legitimacy of the authority. Scare people. What's the opposite of that for a movement? Empower people. Give people some hope. Right. Stop unrest. The opposite is. Create unrest, create mobilization. Same with deter action, right? The opposite would be create, mobilize. Yep. Intimidation. The opposite is, again, empowerment and hope. To flex the regime's muscles. What could a movement do that's the opposite of that? Yeah, you could expose the regime's weakness. Right? Okay, right. Test the loyalty of the movement. What's the opposite of that?
Recruit members of that same movement or like shift their loyalty.
Right, shift loyalty of the regime. And then create bonds, internal bonds within the movement. Or, I'm sorry, within the regime, what would be the opposite of that? Yeah, you could diversify the movement. You could pull those pillars away from the regime opponent. Okay, so what we have here is really instructive because the reasons regimes repress is because they're trying to gain an upper hand in a strategic bargaining situation. Tom Schelling has a really nice preface to a book that was written in 1965 about what's called civilian-based defense. It was a collected volume with Gene Sharp and Basil Littlehart and Adam Roberts and a number of other people that were interested in the sort of deterrent effects of nonviolent resistance. And Tom Schelling says, the tyrant and the movement are in somewhat symmetrical positions, because each one of them can deny the other of what it wants. If this is what an opponent wants through repression, and by the way, we didn't mention it, but I'd add, provoke the movement to use violence and disunify the movement, get it arguing among itself about what's the right course to take, like divide the movement. If those are the things the regime wants to do with the repression, then what the movement can do is deny it from what it wants and do these things, right? The opposite. And the most interesting thing about the opposite that's described here is that it's basically civil resistance, right? It's like the principles of civil resistance. Mobilize mass numbers, diversify, unify the movement, remain disciplined in using nonviolent action, divide the regime from its own pillars of support, give people hope. They're all the things that we're talking about that the power holder does not want, right? And so that's something that's really interesting. And in fact, empirically, one thing that we know, because a lot of people talk about how, you know, unarmed people are helpless, basically, in the face of a committed, armed, repressive opponent, we know that the effects of repression on movements, you know, whether they actually get what they want when they repress movements, are totally all over the place. So this is a sampling of different studies that have been done by scholars on the effects of repression on mobilization. Now, I have to tell you that in these definitions of mobilization, what they're looking at is just protest events, just protest events, so counts of protests in the country. And what happens is in the top left-hand corner, we see the conventional wisdom. The more repression that happens, the less mobilization, the less protest that happens. So that's one set of sort of empirical studies that reinforce that typical notion. But then if you look at the one at the upper right, it becomes much more interesting, where what we see is that at very low levels of repression, we don't see people doing very much because they're not upset, right? At very high levels of repression, we also don't see people doing very much because it's too dangerous. But right in the middling area, where there's some repression, some mid-level of repression, is when we see the highest amount of protest events, because not only are people mad about the repression, but they don't face an opponent that is able to, or capable, to wield enough repressive power to make them go away. This is where most countries fall, by the way, in the spectrum of repressive capacity. They've got some units that'll do it, they've got some units that they're not so sure, and they're not sure that they can do it indefinitely. Then you have a really weird finding, which is the one at the bottom right. This is the U-shaped curve. I don't know why or how this finding came about, but basically the idea is in places where there's no repression, there's a huge level of protest, and then in places where there's really high levels of repression, there's really high levels of protest because people are just so mad that they don't care actually anymore if they're afraid. And then in the middling areas, you don't see very much of anything. And there's a finding, you know, this is a finding in a paper, but it hasn't been replicated too much. And then there's the interesting one in the lower left-hand corner. This is the backfire dynamic, where we actually see that the more repression, the more protest. Okay, that's four sets of conclusions that have been drawn by people. And here's what it actually looks like, which is if you take global data on protest and global data on repression, you don't find any significant relationship. What does that mean? It means that sometimes it's increasing mobilization, sometimes it's decreasing it. It's like all over the map. And I have to tell you that these studies have, in my view, a pretty limited understanding of civil resistance and its dynamics. Because they only look at protest events, they don't look at things like strikes or other techniques of nonviolent action, they don't distinguish between nonviolent and violent protest, which is really critical in understanding the political dynamics of repression and protest. And they don't account for the broader social and political relationships between the dissidents and the opponent. Ralph Summey wrote an excellent article, which I've placed in the E-class, called Nonviolent Resistance Against an Extremely Brutal Opponent. It's a good title. And in it, he talks about the most brutal of brutal tyrants and the ways that civil resistance and nonviolent action have been used against them to effect. And what he says is that whether these movements are successful or not depends in part on the nature of the social relationship between the opponent and the movement. If the relationship is one of what he calls direct dependency, where basically the tyrant depends on the cooperation of the people directly in the society, like for economic wealth, for example. Let's say it's an oil-rich country and your only labor source is your own like ethnic elites and so forth, that's a direct dependency relationship. And we've seen a number of cases where that was true. But then there are also cases where he calls an indirect dependency relationship as being important. And this is where, say it's a very small minority in the society, and because of the limitations on the numbers of people that are available to mobilize, these movements have to actually rely on others in order to expand their numbers and increase their leverage. So these are cases more like East Timor, for example, which as a very small island was not in itself able to secede from Indonesia without significant support from both Indonesian students and then in the longer term, the international community. Secession is a very difficult goal because essentially to do it, the movement has to inspire the entire international community to give recognition. So Gandhi once said that a movement must always include members of the oppressor class. And one of the reasons for this is because we find that loyalty shifts among those pillars of support are often dependent on the degree to which people who reside in them can relate to their own long-term interests in the movement itself. Let me give you a very concrete example of this from the United States context today. I have a good friend and colleague, Chris Davenport, who has done a series of experiments trying to understand when white people in the United States empathize with black protesters. And what he wants to know is the impact of unconscious race bias on people's view of how a conflict is unfolding. So what he did is he asked a bunch of people to come in and do a set of experiments where they read different scenarios and were shown different images. In some of the images, there were only black protesters and there were white police confronting them. In another set of scenarios, it was white protesters and black police confronting them. Then in a third scenario, it was mixed. There were white and black protesters confronting police. And they sort of mixed the racial composition of the police from time to time as well. Now, here's what's very interesting. Black respondents always sympathized with the protesters, regardless of their race. So even when the protesters were white and the police were black, black respondents said that the protesters were not to blame for the confrontation. White respondents did not have the same reaction. White respondents would look at the scene where there were white police and black protesters and always, almost always say that the protesters were to blame. They would also then go and look at the scenario where there were black police and white protesters, and they were just totally confused. Okay? Just total confusion, very strange responses. But when they looked at the scenario where it was mixed race protesters, they were much more likely to say that the police were to blame. So in other words, when they saw their own co-racial identity represented in the movement, they were more likely to say, something's wrong here. Now, this is a terrible conclusion, right? It demonstrates the unconscious power of race bias in a way that's very clear. But it's also what movements have to deal with. It's a reality in many of these different contexts. And so the idea is, you know, how can movements kind of diversify in a way that positions them to take advantage of the different types of indirect dependencies in their societies? I want to show you another very important finding. This one comes from an article put together by Jonathan Sutton, Charles Butcher, and Isak Svensson. They're researchers at Otago University and the University of Uppsala in Sweden. And what they did was they looked at cases where the government used one-sided violence, what they call one-sided violence, against unarmed demonstrators. Now, one-sided violence in the way they define it and the way these data were collected means that in a single episode, the government killed 100 people. Okay, so, and it was one-sided because the people were unarmed. They found 46 cases from 1989 to 2011 where governments used one-sided violence against unarmed demonstrators. So here's the really important finding. In no cases did those demonstrators end up winning the conflict later if they weren't attached to a larger nonviolent campaign. Right, so if it was just, it was kind of spontaneous demonstrations that were happening on their own without the broader organizational framework, zero of them went on to succeed. However, when the one-sided violence, and this is mass repression, this is over 100 people in a single episode, when it occurred against demonstrations that were part of a larger nonviolent campaign, almost half of those campaigns went on to win. And so this demonstrates the absolute power of the sort of organizational capacity that can come to nonviolent movements that strategize pretty well. I also found with my colleague Evan Perkoski that from 1955 to 2013, the most powerful predictor of these types of mass killings, where there's at least 100 people killed, is armed struggle, actually. So there are many, there's a few thousand maybe observations of mass killings. That's when the government is killing 100 people in a single episode. Even the people can be armed in this case. But there are numbers of incidents of this, right? The most common scenario in which this occurs is in the context of armed struggle, counterinsurgency campaigns, scorched earth, mass violence, which is what happens in societies that are engaged in civil conflict. And one of the most powerful predictors of a reduced chance of mass killings is nonviolent resistance. So it's very rare that governments are able to kill that many people in a single episode when the campaigns are using nonviolent resistance. And it becomes even rarer when the campaigns are able to create security force defections and loyalty shifts. When that happens, the probability of this type of violence occurring in a single episode diminishes dramatically. So the method of struggle is having an impact on the political ability of states to use that level of mass lethal violence. And movements actually have a set of options available to them even when their opponents do start to use lethal violence. And I'm going to talk a little bit about shifting from methods of concentration, which is the demonstration, the rally, the procession, the sit-in, to methods of dispersion, which is more when people stay away from places they're expected to go. So for example, If it becomes too risky and too dangerous for a movement to engage in these sort of concentrated disruptive methods, there's a huge tactical set of options for them besides just demonstrations. There are stayaways. You know that if 3 million people in a major urban area stay at home for 3 days, it will destroy the economy. That is a huge power source, underused, and quite safe in many places. It's actually, so the thing with a stay away and a stay at home demonstration is that it's not impossible to repress, but it's really, really costly. The government either has to get all of its state agents to go door to door and intimidate people to come back out, or it basically has to engage in flattening the city, which many regimes will find that their air force is not willing to do. So when regimes have to escalate the level of repression in order to stop a technique from continuing, they always risk that their operatives will say no. And so it's not riskless for these regimes to order mass repression. Every time they do it, they're risking their own future in the country, and many of them know that.
Have you got an example of a stay away where this has happened?
Yeah. So recently, last 10 years. So Stephen Zunis likes to tell this story about a stay away that happened in Western Sahara, where there were a bunch of announcements that there was going to be a demonstration, and sort of the stormtroopers show up in their riot gear and whatever, and actually the Sawari activists had rounded up a bunch of cats and tied the national flag onto their tails, which is illegal to fly the flag. And they said, we're going to go to a demonstration and wear the flag. And so the stormtroopers show up, and instead they released all these cats with flags. And the cats are like running around the bazaar, and the security forces are like chasing the cats, you know, in their riot gear. And it looks very funny. Activists were staying away. That's a stay away demonstration that kind of brought the security forces out in anticipated repression. But cost none of the activists any risk at all. So there's a bunch of different examples. The Iranian Revolution has one of the most powerful examples of this. From 77 to 79, toward the end of the 100 Days Revolution, oil workers went on strike. And in fact, the security forces did go door to door and pull oil workers back onto the streets. They marched them to the oil fields, and when they got there, they worked at half pace. So then the next day, same story, they stay at home. The security forces go door to door, march them down the street, they work at half pace. After 3-4 days of this, security forces start calling in sick. That's all you need. You don't need them to switch sides, you just need them to not show up to work. And then all of a sudden, the Shah's leaving by the end of the week. Yeah.
Like in Nigeria, we've had that, and during one of our presidents that are called stay away.
Uh-huh.
It's very difficult for you to now compel oil workers to go to work because they can sabotage the system.
Mm-hmm.
So it's better they stay off the.
Right.
I mean, from my own experience, you don't tell them to, you don't force them to go.
Right. Right. Yeah. Right. Because if they work at half pace, then it's very costly. Exactly. Right. So this is like a crucial pillar in some societies, not all. But in societies where the continuous operation of the government's heavily dependent on that particular resource, then yeah, that's a really powerful tool for movements. Yes?
I was wondering, because like in Sri Lanka,
mm-hmm.
there were hartals, and those hartals were supposed to be induced stayaways by one of the factions. Maybe when I was in Trincomalee or in Batikolo, there will be you just hear around town that everybody was supposed to stay indoors and live their heart out. Now, within that context, because it was induced by one of the armed movements,
mm-hmm.
you get the Karuna faction, and then maybe the LTTE will now come and say, no, everybody should come out of government. So
mm-hmm.
how does that, is it, do stayaways necessarily have to be voluntary or induced?
Mm-hmm. No, I mean, I think any one of these is basically a technique that has disruptive effects. Obviously, like a lot of armed groups use techniques of nonviolent action as part of their armed campaign. Actually, I'll show you evidence tomorrow morning that suggests that they're actually more effective if they're just part of a mass nonviolent campaign on their own rather than in attendance with armed campaigns. But yes, I mean, sometimes these techniques, although, you know, one of Hardy's elements of his definition of nonviolent action is that it's voluntary, I think it's actually really difficult to observe that. And I think that in many contexts, people feel compelled for many reasons to engage in nonviolent action. And the reality is that the political effects of it are what they are, regardless of why people are doing it. So I mean, that's my take. It's different from many of the people here. So in terms of backfire, okay, so I want to talk a little bit about the options. So we talked about shifting methods and innovating new techniques of nonviolent action to either maneuver when repression happens. I mean, this is just one of these basic principles of war fighting. If you're, I did my PhD in sort of security studies, so we think a lot about just war fighting. And one of the things that people don't do in war is have the same battle over and over and over again. It's not a way to advance the conflict if all the people are doing is going out of the trench and running across the open field every day at noon at the same time. This is a sure way to either be in a war of attrition for 4 years that kills 20 million people, like World War I did, or it's a way to basically, if you're a nonviolent movement, get repressed a lot. And so, you know, moving between methods is crucial in these contexts as it might be in war fighting. Of course, a lot of times when movements are repressed, they do maintain the status quo. They do just try to return to their playbook because of various reasons. And in that sense, you know, sometimes you might get a really lucky break. Like sometimes for whatever reason, the tide shifts and public opinion comes in the movement's favor. And then sometimes, you know, movements are able to capitalize on the incidence of repression, even though if they do so cynically by directly provoking the repression, this can really be negative for the movement's image. But certainly that has happened. And then, of course, my personal favorite, because I'm a total coward, is to retreat and regroup, which is simply consistent with this notion that it's sometimes okay to lose a battle as long as you're still around to win the war. As Yvonne was saying, there's no need for martyrdom. There's no need. But if it happens, we have a colleague named Brian Martin who's talked about backfire. And backfire is the process in which the opposite of what the regime wants is what occurs. So it's like when the repression actually creates these outputs rather than demobilization. Now, this is basically a process that he observed in his excellent book that he published in 2007 called Justice Ignited, The Dynamics of Backfire. And this is a term that is somewhat consistent with terms like political jujitsu or the boomerang effect that other scholars have used. And as you can tell from the terminology, part of the idea is that when the regime attempts to expose its strength through repression, a movement reacts to that by exposing the weakness of the regime. Has anybody heard of Hannah Arendt? Okay, she's a philosopher. And Hannah Arendt wrote a book called On Violence, or a series of essays. And in it, she says that the funny thing about, well, she doesn't say the funny thing. I'm paraphrasing now. The funny thing about violence is everyone thinks that it signals power, but it actually signals weakness. Because if you cannot get the voluntary consent and obedience of the people in your society, you are weak. So how do movements capitalize on that weakness? Well, Brian Martin says that sometimes we see repression empower the movement, weaken the opponent, and boost participation, which is maybe one of the most important things that it can do, and actually elicit the support of third parties, which could be defections, it could be external supporters of the movement, or it could be allies of the regime who decide to abandon it. And that can be a very powerful and potent moment in the life of one of these campaigns. Brian Martin suggests that movements can actually do things to manage repression, not cause it, but when it occurs, they can manage the political effects and make backfire more likely. And he talks about this by doing a couple of key tasks. The first is demonstrating that that act of repression is unjust excessive and disproportional to what the people are trying to do. Now, here's the thing. It's actually way easier to do that if the movement is nonviolent than if it's armed. Because a lot of people, we see a generalized pattern that when movements arm themselves and they start to use violence, public opinion generally, not always, but generally moves toward the government to restore order, because the monopoly on the use of force that the government claims to have has been threatened, and people feel like their lives are threatened and they want the government to protect them. So if movements are nonviolent, it makes any repression that occurs appear unjust, unfair, and disproportional. The second thing Martin talks about is the necessity of communicating that action, so publicizing it. And a lot of movements these days do this through cameras and, you know, other things that actually capture the moment in ways that make it obvious what just happened, so that it's very difficult for the opponents to cover it up. They will try to cover it up, though. And so he suggests a need to prepare to counter censorship and spinning of the event. So, you know, all of those things that these are just coup plotters, they're thugs, they're criminals, and they're terrorists, and they're threatening our way of life. You know, when these movements are able actually to counter that regime propaganda by shining light on what actually happened, he says that it's more likely that the repressive incident will backfire for the regime. Now, I did a little study that was trying to understand which elements of backfire are the most important for campaigns. Like which types of backfire, indicators of backfire, are more likely to lead to long-term campaign success. And what I found is that actually there are two really important ones here. The first is the defections from the opponent, so security force or civilian bureaucrat defections. And the second one was the removal of support for the regime. So this is like the United States calling Ferdinand Marcos, not the United States, but Ronald Reagan. That would be a loud phone call, right? 300 million people. So Ronald Reagan calling Ferdinand Marcos and saying, you're on your own, because we're not going to support you in slaughtering your own people. And that was a very key moment. Marcos kind of gave up after that. Now, of course, there was a huge nonviolent movement. There were lots of other defections that occurred. It was inevitable that that movement was going to win, probably. But the timing of that phone call was really important in determining the timing of Marcos's departure. So if an opponent ally withdraws support and the security forces defect, that's the end of the game. And this is very instructive, I think, for movements. They're not winning because they're right. Right? They're not winning because they are the good guys. They're winning because their actions have really important political effects for the power holder's ability to hang on. I'm going to move quickly through the last bits here, then we'll talk about all this stuff. In various different FSIs, I've heard some things that I thought were pretty helpful. If I ever was an activist myself, as I've told you, I'm more of an astronomer than an astronaut. but actually, a couple of these things really struck me as being things I would want to know. The first thing is that we know that torture and sexual violence are much more likely to happen to people in detention. This is true in any country. This is true here in the United States, that people in detention are extremely vulnerable because they're alone, and people alone are very vulnerable, especially in situations of contained power asymmetry. So for activists and movements, the implication here is getting people out as fast as possible. And Yvonne can talk, I think, a little bit about this, and I know many of you can talk about this from your experiences of mobilizing to respond to somebody being arrested or detained and how you get them out. But the key insight here is getting people out as soon as possible. The second thing is this idea of that there is power in numbers. There's safety in numbers. Sometimes people are alone for one reason or another in their homes or whatnot, and there are many resources available to get people accompanied to make them more secure. And Catherine, you know, was part of an organization that dispatches accompaniers, unarmed accompaniers, to try to keep people safe in their context that they're operating, human rights workers and so forth, because it's less likely that things happen to people when they're in groups. And then In terms of getting the truth out, one thing that Mary King has taught me, which I think is a brilliant lesson for activists, is to not exaggerate how bad it is. And the reason is because the regime can just use that to discredit the movement so fast that they lose all their ability to sort of inspire hope in the population. And in fact, when she was working as a communications operator for SNCC, she would write up press releases with her colleagues about how many people were arrested, how many people had been visibly abused, and so forth. And if I'm telling this wrong, you should correct me, but her comment that really struck me is that because black people's injury and death in the US and the South at that time was not considered newsworthy, what she would often do is undercount or deflate the number of people that actually had been hurt. And that her press reports are the ones that ended up being carried by the New York Times and the Washington Post and everything else, because they were viewed as more credible. The people simply didn't believe how many people were actually being hurt. They thought the numbers were too high. And that one way to guard against that and to look like you are a credible source telling the truth is actually to undercount or underestimate. And actually, this is a difficult thing. I count conflict data for a living. And what I can tell you is that it's very hard in the moment to know exactly what's going on. Because you'll have a situation where there's a big protest, there's thousands of people out there, and then all of a sudden you hear, well, there were 49 people injured. How do we know? From eyewitnesses. Well, how do I know if it wasn't six eyewitnesses seeing the same person? And that looks like six people, right? But it's one person. It's a very difficult challenge. And so movements, I think, are better suited by not exaggerating or trying to really verify and get the facts straight so that they don't look like they're lying and trying to make things worse than they are. And then, of course, there's the thing that nobody really wants to talk about, which is like taking care of oneself and whatever that help looks like, emotional, kind of spiritual or psychological assistance, I think is really critical for staying power. I cannot tell you this from cross-national empirical evidence, but my hunch is that that it's critical for movement resilience. Did you want to comment, Aya?
You just reminded me of an example in Syria when the Syrian activists, they were reporting on death in Yarmouk camp.
Yeah.
And they actually changed the accounts of people because they wanted the UN to get people out. So they diminished increased the number of people living
right.
in Yarmouk to show that there are a lot of people to be saved there, but the number was totally half of the people still existing there. Because
right.
international attention wouldn't go if there is few people staying in Yarmouk.
Right.
So absolutely the number matter. And another activist who are Syrians, but not from Palestinian Syrians, who were saying the exact numbers were attacked by these activists because basically they're not serving the cause of Yarmouk. So that also creates clashes between movements mm-hmm. and how they see things.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Mohammed, and then I'm going to finish up.
Just as we said, you know, when you're on the situations are different country to country.
Yeah.
There was a time in Nigeria that the military government, they were, you know, picking up oppositions, you know, mm-hmm. civil rights movement, union leaders. So there was this time that there was this strike. Mm-hmm. And the union leader himself kidnapped himself. So when he kidnapped himself, everybody was saying, oh, government have done it again. We demand you bring this guy out, you know. Mm. It was later on that when he came out, that very close to that, okay, he actually kidnapped himself, you know, to embarrass the government.
Huh. Interesting. So I think the bottom line here is basically that, you know, for movements that are challenging any type of major system in their countries, that they can expect a violent reaction from the opponent. And the fact that these movements are right and just does not protect them from the fact that their opponent is extremely committed to maintaining its privileges, staying in power, and actually keeping order, which is kind of the number one goal of many states. So the second point to know is that you know, mass amounts of repression, yes, they damage movements. It makes it slightly less likely than average for movements to succeed the more repression they face. But it doesn't necessarily doom them. And in fact, almost half of the movements that have faced massive repression, even mass killings from their governments, have actually succeeded in the end. These movements can be catalytic for movements and actually provide them in a way with the spark for ultimate success. And so the idea here is that if we buy the argument that Brian Martin has laid out for us, that there may actually be some strategic choices, ways to prepare, and sort of skills to develop that allow these movements to manage the political effects of that repression. So this is very different from kind of the conventional line about nonviolent movements. I can tell you that when I came to this study, my main objection to this material was that nonviolent resistance could not work against a highly armed and repressive opponent. And the data tell us a totally different story. So I think that that's really important. And you know, I want to just close on this kind of jolly note. My friend Yvonne here tells this wonderful story about Niels Bohr, because he's a scientist. And Niels Bohr is a nuclear physicist, a Danish man, who I guess had some cabin in the woods, very kind of cerebral, rational thinker. And his student came to visit him in his cabin and noticed that Niels Bohr had a horseshoe over the top of his door. And his student said, "Professor Bohr, what is that above your door?" And he said, "It's a horseshoe." He says, "Yeah, but why do you have it? Are you a superstitious man?" And he said, they say that it brings good luck. And he says, "Yeah, but you're a scientist. You don't really believe in luck, right?" And he said, "Well, they say it works even if you don't believe in it." So this is the note to end on with civil resistance, that half the time I wake up in the morning and I'm like, what are we talking about? This stuff doesn't work. And that's just all the sort of information that's been put in my mind over the course of my life, that violence is the only way out for movements and that violence is the only way to react to violence. And thank goodness the data tell us a different story that challenged those prior beliefs and ask us to look deeply at what the alternatives might be.
It's like quantum physics. We don't understand it, yeah. But it works.
Exactly. Yeah, I don't actually know that the Earth rotates around the sun, right? But we know a bunch of different things that would tell us that that was the case, and thank goodness for that. So, Jindan.
So my question is related to your correlation between repression and resistance.
Yep.
And as far as the Tibetan movement is concerned, especially during 2008, so a lot of people were trying to understand why the uprising happened.
Yep.
And of course, I think he wrote comprehensively on why why this happened from his perspective. But also, there were one argument or one understanding that perhaps if you look at the timeline of different uprisings inside Tibet, you have one in 1959,
yep.
followed by 87 and 2008, and in between those timelines, there is a gap of around 20 to 30 years. So there is this one understanding that it could perhaps be just there's a new generation, there's a generational change.
Mm-hmm.
So in your research, mm-hmm. have you ever come across any kind of similar findings?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a great question. So in some of my research that looks at the onset of nonviolent campaigns, I found actually that even having a history of nonviolent campaigns does not increase the chances that a country will have a new one. So it's kind of interesting because it would suggest, if a country had a really deep history in this, you'd expect them to be more likely to use it. But we find that it happens in all kinds of countries, even those that have no prior recorded experience with it. And one thing that is the case, though, is that in countries where there have been a number of kind of failed attempts before, that doesn't actually mean that they can't win the next time. So there's no real correlation between prior failure and future failure. So it's sort of really counterintuitive that, campaigns emerge for really unpredictable reasons. In a way, they succeed because of the particular skill of that campaign at that moment, rather than everything that came before. Yes, Haroon.
Actually, the presentation slide that was on repression that half government used and the opponents used, we currently experience it in Afghanistan.
Mm-hmm.
Over the last 6-7 years, the civic movements, particularly some civil society organizations, have prepared and their wife prepared, their Africa recognized to a level. What seems now, particularly the way that we have very two major cases that currently going on, is the EVA law, we say, eradication of women law, which is mostly about the law that it protects women. And the other thing that probably colleagues would have heard of is Farhunda case, that she was badly assassinated by some of the citizens there. The way the civil society stood against these both cases, the government, in a way, and the conservative wings, particularly the previous jihadi, very Islamic and radical groups, stood against it and used this repression that they are being, the civil society group is being doing things un-Islamic, mostly they tie it to the religion in order to repress them. And the other thing actually is the government, particularly when they see that a lot of pressure is coming up and they see now the civil society is becoming to a level effective, they just say that these are somehow being funded by international and embassies or the United States or Westerners, somehow to have their own agenda through the civil society groups. Mm-hmm. So definitely this is the real challenge for our civil society, mm-hmm. and the civil society we have currently in Afghanistan, mm-hmm. Particularly the way that they mobilize things and mobilize some of the protests and movements within Kabul, the capital. Mm-hmm. There are a few protests and some relevant things in some of the distant areas, particularly in the provinces in the mm-hmm. country, but these are the real challenges that us mm-hmm. opposites to what the repression is, mm-hmm. why it happens. It really helps overall, mm-hmm. as we go back to there and do some sort of more training and more sessions to learn and each other. This will really help us. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and right, that's great. And we have Maria Stefan, who's going to weigh in later today about the political dynamics of external actors and how movements deal with that. Aaron, did you have a comment? You didn't raise your hand? Okay, Adehio.